Well, it is a privilege to be here with you tonight. I've enjoyed meeting so many of you and connecting with you, and let's jump in. I grew up in a home without Christ, without the gospel. My dad was a tavern owner. He was extremely hostile to the gospel. He hated churches, and he especially hated pastors. My parents' relationship was rocky. They'd both been divorced, and as a kid, I always thought maybe my parents were going to get a divorce by the grace of God. They never did, and ultimately had the joy of leading my mom to Christ shortly after I became a Christian, and then many years later, leading my dad to Christ when he was 85 years old and dying of cancer. But that was the home I grew up in. I had no reference points related to the gospel. I had many questions. I escaped to comic books and science fiction, and I was always conscious of longing for something that was bigger than me. Well, nearly everything was bigger than me, but I was really looking for something big, something important, and astronomy was my hobby. I would go out every clear night. Now, in Oregon, not every night is clear, but every clear night, I would be out there with my telescope, and I would be studying the stars, and I would read book after book after book on astronomy. And I remember one night looking at the great galaxy of Andromeda, and I had read it was 2.5 million light years away. And they said in those days that the universe was probably 10 billion light years across. Now that's been expanded to 100 billion light years, some say 150 billion light years. And you know, the universe really isn't getting bigger. We're just able to find out how big it is, except the number just keeps increasing. And I was in awe at all that. And I was thinking about the great galaxy of Andromeda. If this thing disappeared tonight, if it exploded, we would still see its light for 2.5 million years. That's how far away it is. We can't even conceive a light minute, even a light second, that distance. But a light minute, a light hour, a light year, how about 100 billion light years? And how many trillions of galaxies, not just trillions of stars, but trillions of galaxies that contain hundreds of billions of stars. And I'm looking at Andromeda and reading that there may be as many as a trillion stars in this galaxy. And I'm thinking, this is so cool. This is big. This is, didn't use the word then, but awesome. It filled me with awe. But I remember one night looking through that telescope and suddenly tears streaming down my face as a boy, because whatever the universe was about, I was on the outside. I didn't know what it was. I had no concept of God whatsoever, did not believe in God. I hadn't heard about God. Well, I put away that telescope because there was this gnawing emptiness in me. And night after night, while I enjoyed looking at the wonder of it all, I was so disconnected. I didn't know what it was all about. And in retrospect, I realized God was doing Romans 1 to me, you know, seeing in what God had made, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature. In retrospect, I realized I wanted to worship, but I didn't know who to worship and how to worship. And the reason I wept was because I felt so incredibly small and alone and empty and separated. Well, several years later, fast forward, I'm in high school, and I attended a church youth group to see a girl who coincidentally is sitting there in the front row. It's my wife, Nancy. And my daughter, Angela, sitting next to her. Okay, so this story relates to you too. And my son-in-law, Dan. We keep the applause going, okay. All right, so anyway, I went to this youth group, and I started hearing some things about Jesus, but I went home, I got a Bible, I opened up the Bible, and I started reading it. Well, guess where I started? Genesis 1:1. And I saw words that I had never heard. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Wow. Wow. I'm going, so it's saying that he made the heavens, and I knew enough to know that that's the celestial heavens that I would look at night, including that great galaxy of Andromeda, and he had made the earth and he had made me. Now, I didn't believe that, but that's what the claim was. And he was apparently a person. I had no reference points when I read the Bible, so it was not just Leviticus that confused me, okay? It was everything. But when I got to the Gospels and started reading about Jesus, everything about him had the ring of truth. And I felt a stirring inside myself, and I realized one night, late in the Gospel of Matthew, or maybe it was by the time I'd gone through Mark and into Luke, I realized one night, I was believing what I was reading. And it was a miracle of grace, because I'd gone from thinking this was fiction, like Jesus was a superhero, like in the comic books or something like that, to realizing this has the ring of truth. This Jesus, I think he's actually real. And one night I got down on my knees and I'd heard enough in youth group, something about sin and repenting and that sort of thing, and knowing that Jesus was the one that I needed to confess to, and I gave my life to Christ and experienced conversion. Well, I was hungry for truth, and so I regularly visited a Christian bookstore which was in the garage of a private home, and I found a book called The Problem of Pain. And it was the first time I had ever seen the name C.S. Lewis. That name meant absolutely nothing to me. But I was stunned by his insight and his clarity. He remembered what it was like to not know God. And I'd only known God for a few months when I'm reading The Problem of Pain. It probably, if you were going to give somebody a Lewis book to read, you wouldn't start with The Problem of Pain, but that's what was there on the shelf in the providence of God. That's where I started. It had a huge impact on me. And it wasn't just because of what he said. It's because of who he was. It's because he talked about not knowing God. And I very recently, as in terms of just months, had not known God. And now I realized that here's a guy who spent a large part of his life not knowing God, and he's come to faith in God. And then I went back to the store after finishing The Problem of Pain. I thought, has he written anything else? So I go back to the L's. Everything was spine out. There were no covers out, like 1,000 books, you know, but you just had to look at the spines. And there I take out Out of the Silent Planet, and then next to it is Paralandra. And then next to it is That Hideous Strength. And I look at him and I realize this is science fiction. I thought I was going to have to give up science fiction, which I love. I figured, being a young Christian and just picking up little vibes in my church, that imagination was probably a sin. And so, you know what? And so I thought, and then all of a sudden I went, the same guy that wrote this great stuff over here about Jesus and about God's plan and about, you know, human sin and suffering and all that, also wrote science fiction. And it was like, wow, this is so cool. Maybe I don't have to give up science fiction. So then I sat down and read those through, and each of them, but Paralandra in particular, the depth of the theology in that book with Weston, the unmanned ransom, from all the story. If you've read it, if you haven't read it, you have no idea what I'm talking about. But if you've read it, you know how powerful it is and what an impression it made on me. It was imaginative theology, but it fleshed it out for me, and it was very real. So then I did something interesting after reading the space trilogy, I went over to the corner of a basement where my telescope was, and I hadn't looked through it for several years. The last time I'd looked through it is when I just emotionally was just breaking down in tears because I didn't know what the universe was about. I took the telescope back out. I looked through it. I found it was summer. I found the great galaxy of Andromeda. And I looked at it again, and once more I wept, but this time for a different reason. Because now I knew the God who I didn't know before. And he had come into my life. He had changed me. He had transformed me. And now I knew that I was on the inside instead of the outside. And I remember also when I was reading in Genesis 1 that first time when I came to verse 14. And it says, five words? And he made the stars also. And that really blew me away because I'm going, that's got to be the biggest, understatement in human history. He made the stars also, at the time thinking 10 billion light years now, maybe 150 billion light years across, and it just gets five words. That's all it's worth. And then to find out later that he made it with his fingers, and I knew that God. But C.S. Lewis walked me through all this, both with his nonfiction and his fiction. And then I read Narnia, and truth jumped out at me from every page. In Prince Caspian, I read, "You come of the Lord Adam and the Lady Eve," said Aslan, "and that is both honor enough to erect the head of the poorest beggar and shame enough to bow the shoulders of the greatest emperor on earth." Less than 40 words and like 100 pages of theology in that. Amazing. Aslan is not a tame lion. Aslan is not safe, but he's good. Aslan is on the move. And seeing that Aslan was Jesus, I'm learning about Jesus, not only from my reading of Scripture, but imaginatively through the world of Narnia. Lewis was the first one to help me grapple with the big questions. That book, The Problem of Pain, he described how he used to argue against the Christian faith. And here's what he said. Here I am, this brand new Christian, and I'm listening to what this guy says. "Not many years ago," Lewis says, "when I was an atheist, if anyone had asked me, 'Why do you not believe in God?' my reply would have been, 'Look at the universe we live in. History is largely a record of crime, war, disease, and terror. The universe is running down. All stories will come to nothing. All life will turn out in the end to have been a transitory and senseless contortion upon the idiotic face of infinite matter. If you ask me to believe that this is the work of a benevolent and omnipotent spirit, I reply that all the evidence points in the opposite direction. Either there is no spirit behind the universe, or else a spirit indifferent to good and evil, or else an evil spirit." And I go, whoa, wow, that's a powerful argument. But what I loved about it is, think about this. Has Richard Dawkins ever said anything more persuasive than that? This is why we've got to help our young people hold C.S. Lewis's hand and walk through the problem of evil and suffering way before they get to college, even before they get to high school. They've got to work this through because otherwise they're going to have some professor who's going to bring up for the first time the problem of evil and suffering. No, that should be dealt with all along the way and much earlier and by sympathetic people like C.S. Lewis, because their college professors are not going to normally be sympathetic. And honestly, many of them virtually all of them will be intellectual pygmies compared to Lewis. But nonetheless, let's take them somewhere where they can get some good grounding in dealing with these serious problems, which the Bible does. How long, O Lord? The problem of evil and suffering is developed in Scripture, and it's answered. But the great thing is,
Lewis had turned to the Christian faith because he believed that it had greater explanatory power by far than his atheism did. This fed me. This bolstered me. This allowed me to speak up more boldly as I'm sharing with my friends this new faith. All my friends at that time were unbelievers, and they couldn't believe what, you know, was happening with me.
A couple of years ago, I reread The Problem of Pain and A Grief Observed, one right after the other. The Problem of Pain is more reasoned and logical. A Grief Observed contains all this raw suffering because it was written after the death of Joy Lewis, his wife for just 4 years when she had died of cancer. And Lewis's grief is so palpable, it's so raw, it's so overwhelming. But those two books beautifully complement each other, contrary to one of the movies called Shadowlands. There's two movies about the life of Lewis, both called Shadowlands. One was a BBC production, which for the most part is more accurate. Then there was the more Hollywood version of Shadowlands, where Lewis is played by Anthony Hopkins. Just to clarify, this is a movie in which Anthony Hopkins doesn't eat anyone. He plays C.S. Lewis. He's this ivory tower professor who knows nothing about suffering, supposedly. And then, when Joy dies of cancer, it portrays him as doubting what he had earlier written in The Problem of Pain. Well, at the movie's end, those of you who've seen it will remember this, Lewis sits down in the attic next to his young stepson, Douglas Gresham. And Doug Gresham is the one who you saw in the video last night who introduced this conference. And over the years, the real-life Doug Gresham has become a friend. And we have discussed this false portrayal of Lewis as not knowing suffering until Joy's death. I think it's important to clarify this in contradiction to the movie, the real life story. Because in Surprised by Joy, Lewis tells of the death of his mother when he was only 10 years old. He says this, "With my mother's death, all settled happiness, all that was tranquil and reliable disappeared from my life. There was to be no more of the old security. It was all sea and islands now. The great continent, like Atlantis, had slid under the waves." In boarding schools, Lewis was abused by bullies. One of those boarding schools had a headmaster who was actually declared insane. As a young man, Lewis was on the battlefields of World War I, this terribly vicious, bloody war. He was hit by shrapnel in three places. One of those was so close to his heart that it was never removed. By age 19, Lewis had seen dozens and dozens of comrades who had become friends slaughtered in battle. For years, Doug Gresham says, Lewis suffered terrible nightmares about being back in the trenches. This is all by age 19, this man who had known no suffering, right? No, he knew suffering. Of course, the suffering with Joy was another level of suffering and her loss, but he was alienated from his disapproving father, though he was phenomenally popular with students at his Oxford College, Magdalen. They never offered him a full professorship or an academic chair. That came later with Cambridge. They resented his Christian faith. He spent many years caring for Mrs. Moore, who was this demanding and hypercritical mother of a friend who had died in the war. He had the daily burdens of letter writing, various ailments, and his brother Warney's alcoholism. All of this took its toll. So, The Problem of Pain is not a naive, unrealistic perspective of someone that was ignorant about true suffering. In it, Lewis said this, "God, who has made us, knows what we are and that our happiness lies in Him. Yet, we will not seek it in Him as long as He leaves us any other resort where it can even plausibly be looked for. While what we call our own life remains agreeable, we will not surrender it to Him. What then can God do in our interests but make our own life less agreeable to us and take away the plausible sources of false happiness. A profound analysis. Suffering can be the road to transforming grace, and Lewis walked that road. And many of us, I hope most of us, are in the process of walking that road. Not that I want us to suffer, just knowing that life brings suffering. So is it going to be a suffering that is used by God in His grace to transform us? Many Christians see from a prosperity theology perspective, whether they know that or not, when suffering comes, they believe that God has failed them. But God's love and goodness do not mean life will go the way we want it to go. Have you noticed that? Have you noticed that? Yeah. Well, I've noticed that, and Lewis noticed that. Lewis asks, what do people mean when they say, I am not afraid of God because I know He's good? Have they never been to a dentist? When Joy got sick, he wrote to one of his friends, we are not necessarily doubting that God will do the best for us. We are just wondering how painful the best will turn out to be. Great insight. Paul captures the eternal remedy to evil and suffering in Romans 8. In verse 18, if you got access to a Bible, open it up, take a look at it. Romans 8:18, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. Some translations are to us, it could go either way. Lewis cites Romans 8:18, this verse, in The Problem of Pain, and then he says this, a book on suffering which says nothing about heaven is leaving out almost the whole of one side of the account. Scripture and tradition habitually put the joys of heaven onto the scale against the sufferings of earth, and no solution of the problem of pain which does not do so can be called a Christian one. So true. If you try to resolve the problem of evil and suffering in this lifetime, not going to happen. Yet strangely, there are Christian books, and I've read a number of them, on evil and suffering, which say virtually nothing about heaven. Present sufferings, though, according to Scripture, must be seen in light of the promises of God for eternity, eternal happiness in God. The present world we live in under the curse, this is an aberration. This is not the norm. To us, we say, well, suffering is normal in this life, but sin is not normal. Suffering is not normal. They're abnormal. In eternity past, God lived all this time, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, before He created the universe, and there was no sin, there was no curse, there was no suffering. And in eternity future, after this life, this very brief period of time where creatures are in rebellion against their Creator, where that aberration is going on, in the scale of eternity, it will in retrospect have been such a small amount of time. And that's critical in order to understand any kind of biblical resolution to the problem of evil and suffering. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4:17, this light and momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. So we look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are unseen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are unseen are eternal. That's the eternal perspective we need to bring to this life. Now, if you want to see what Paul means in his own life by light and momentary affliction, just read 2 Corinthians 11, and it'll blow you away in terms of the suffering he went through that he called light and momentary. Because we know that there are sufferings that weigh heavily on the scales. Holocausts, rapes, human trafficking, torture, children dying of leukemia and starvation. So whatever is on the other side of those scales,
must be weighty beyond all comprehension to outweigh those. I think it's just critical to understand that God is not minimizing human suffering when he makes this comparison. At first you might think he does. Well, it's light and momentary, like it's no big deal. Oh no, Paul understands suffering. It's weighty. But let's say you take a boulder, something huge. Maybe it's the Rock of Gibraltar. I mean, some huge mass, and you say, that is very weighty. And then you say, let's put on the other side of the scales over here, let's put, let's say, the planet Jupiter. All of a sudden you go, wow. Not denying that a boulder's big. If it falls on you, it hurts. Well, maybe not for long. But the point is, the boulder's big. The Rock of Gibraltar's big. But you put a planet on the scales over here, and it outweighs it. So what we got to do is understand, what is it that Paul's talking about that so far outweighs the sufferings of this present time that they could be called light and momentary, even when they're severe as they were in Paul's life? Well, Satan, the liar, seeks to deceive us about the nature of heaven and the resurrection. What he does is he convinces us that eternity will be disembodied, that it will be floating around like a ghost. It will be therefore inhuman. It will be boring. It will be unappealing. You can't teach a person to like to eat gravel. They can eat a bunch of gravel, but they're not going to develop a taste for it. Why? Because we're not wired to eat gravel. We're not wired to be disembodied spirits. No child's goal is to grow up one day and be a ghost. That's just not what it is. And so we develop this mentality as believers where we say, well, okay, there's life in this world right now, and there's the physical world, and there's something wrong with that. And one day we'll be delivered from this physical world. And Plato had teachings similar to this, and we'll be unchained from the physical world, and then we'll be disembodied spirits forever, and God will deliver us out of this world. Therefore, I better have a bucket list. So, because I want to do this, 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 and this. I want to do these things that you can still do in this world and be happy, right? And I want to have barbecues, and I want to go to ball games, and I want to go to this place and that place. Maybe it's Niagara Falls, or maybe it's the Grand Canyon, or maybe it's Lake Victoria, or maybe it's this place, and the Amazon, and whatever. That's on my bucket list because, after all, this life is the only life, you only go around once on this earth, right? This old saying, and we're not here long and all that. Well, actually, according to the Bible, if you are redeemed, you're going to go around twice on this earth, except this earth transformed into the new earth, and the second time is going to last forever. That changes your perspective about an embodied existence, because now all of a sudden you're saying, well, all these things on my bucket list, like I want to eat this food go to this place and all of that. You say, well, wait a minute. Really? Is this my only chance in this world? So, in Romans 8, verse 19, the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. Everywhere you look, you can see that something's gone terribly wrong with the world. The creation was subjected to futility, verse 20. As the human stewards of the earth fell, all creation fell with them or under them. The world fell on our coattails, so to speak. This is the curse, and as Adam's descendants, we experience the curse, yet we're left with this nostalgia for Eden, a place we've not known. Verse 21, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God, the same creation that fell on our coattails as fallen humanity shall rise on our coattails. For we know, verse 22, that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. Now, the pains of childbirth, it's dangerous anytime a man talks about childbirth, okay? So I'll just say that the pains of childbirth are fundamentally different than other kinds of pain. The pains of death are one thing, but the pains of childbirth are looking towards something and are actually helping bring about something that is new life. So it's talking about an earth that's dying that's going to give birth to something new. What? Well, to a new earth. The whole creation that's groaning and longing is eventually going to be delivered on the heels of God's children. We see this clearly in verse 23. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. This is the hinge on which the problem of suffering turns. God groans with us. The Holy Spirit intercedes for us. So the key here to creation's redemption is our resurrection. It's not just our bodies that will rise. It's the earth itself. Not only will we become all God intended us to be, but the earth will become all God intended it to be. So in the garden, you have God saying to the first man and woman, I've made you from the earth to rule the earth, have dominion for my glory. And then what happened? Sin comes into the world and God's plan is thwarted, right? I mean, Satan must have, gotten the victory there because God had to change his plan, right? Righteous men and women are no longer going to rule the earth to the glory of God because Adam and Eve sinned and they sinned soon. So it's not going to happen, right? No, it is going to happen because Satan is not more powerful than God. The redemptive plan of God did not get changed at that moment where God said, the best I can do is from now on, I'll send my son to the cross, and then from that point forward, I'll snatch their spirits out of the world so they can live forever as disembodied spirits in the angelic realm. And that's the best I can do now. But I've completely abandoned my plan that they would rule the earth to the glory of God. Now, Jesus didn't come into the world to provide an alternative to the original plan of God, but to fulfill the original plan of God and to make it better than it ever would have been had there not been sin, had there not been a fall. These things were not out of God's hands. Do you believe that? He had a redemptive plan. And we're told that it's gonna reach out to all of creation. How far will redemption reach? Isaac Watts, who wasn't just a great hymn writer, but a great theologian, nailed it in Joy to the World when he says, far as the curse is found. However far the curse goes, that's how far redemption goes. So if you believe, as I do, that probably every molecule of the universe somehow has come under the curse, certainly every molecule of earth, and I think there's every reason to believe that it all fell, the entire creation. Man and woman were to be kings and queens of the earth, the center of God's plan in this great vast universe he made. And it all got messed up, except in the plan of God, it ultimately isn't messed up because Jesus came to redeem not only us, not only our spirits, but our bodies, and not only our spirits and bodies, whole person, but the earth itself, including, very obviously, the animals, because who else? The whole creation groans in suffering and looks forward to the deliverance that's going to come with the resurrection of God's children. Well, who besides human beings on this earth is suffering? Animals. I'm from the Pacific Northwest, and we think there that trees have souls, and so people change them. But not really. But the idea is, you could symbolically, figuratively say that the forests are groaning, but you can literally say that animals are suffering. And what does Isaiah 65:17 say?
Behold, I will create new heavens and a new earth. And 8 verses later, it said something that I think was in John's prayer. The wolf and the lamb will feed together. The lion will eat straw like an ox. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountains, says the Lord. Now that passage may have, we come from different theological perspectives here, but that passage may have some application to a millennial kingdom, but without a doubt, it refers primarily to the new earth. The big hint for that is that it actually says new earth. It says that. I know there are interpretive issues in this passage, but whenever it can be understood to be new earth, like with the animals and the harmony and all of that, I think we need to understand it that way. 2 Peter 3:13 says, in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heavens and a new earth, the home of righteousness. Now, even if we weren't told about the new earth, we would have to deduce it. Because physical resurrection bodies, which we're told emphatically we're going to have, need somewhere physical to live. It just doesn't work floating around in clouds. Now, a new car is a car. It's not a non-car. Follow me in this logic. A new body is a body, or it wouldn't be called a body. A new earth is an earth. New is the adjective, earth is the noun. Nouns are the main thing. Adjectives describe nouns, they do not negate nouns. I mean, unless God said, I'm going to give you a non-body, or I'm going to make a non-earth. But he doesn't say non, he says new. Therefore, the new bodies will be real bodies, and the new earth will be a real earth. God has a great vocabulary. He wouldn't use that terminology of new body and new earth unless he meant it. God is very smart. One of the greatest gifts, and he's a good communicator. One of the greatest gifts we can give our children and grandchildren is to teach them the doctrines of the resurrection and the new earth. Because these truths will give them a big view of God so that we can say, you're going to live with Jesus forever. We've probably told them that. But here's the beautiful thing. You're not going to drift around as a spirit, and Jesus isn't going to be drifting around as a spirit, because how are you with someone if you don't have a body and they don't have a body? No, our resurrection bodies are going to be like Christ. Jesus will put his arms around you. You can hold his hand. You can run and jump and play. You can bow your knees before him and pray to him and say, thank you, Jesus, for what you've done in my life. Give your children that biblical picture. I'm not saying say this to them because this is desirable. It is desirable. But say it to them because it is true. It is true. And there are so many children who grow up fearing what it's going to be like to go and be with Jesus because they've been told, they either have the idea that they're going to be ghostly and, you know, floating around, or they've been told, and I've talked to people who have told me this. I literally was told in my Sunday school class, we won't know anyone. You won't know your family. You won't know in heaven. Well, why would anyone even say that? And the answer is it's based on one verse out of context, completely out of context, in Isaiah 65. But that's used to just obliterate personality and continuity of who you are. No, the real you is going to be there in heaven. Let's teach our children that. Hebrews 11:16 talks about people who are longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Why were they longing for a better country? Because they were longing for God. They wanted to be with God, and God lives in God's country. Chronicles of Narnia. Where does Aslan live? He comes to visit Narnia sometimes, but where does he live? In Aslan's country. So why does Reepicheep the mouse want to go to Aslan's country? To be with Aslan. It's all about Jesus. We're made for a person and we're made for a place. Jesus is the person, heaven is the place. But the place is meaningless if Jesus isn't there. It's all about being with
God. And so what God promises us is amazing. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says, if in Christ we have hope, in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. So physical suffering on earth cannot be rectified by a disembodied existence in another world. It can only, those are apples and oranges. Scripture talks about, Romans 8 talks about apples and apples. A suffering life on earth is remedied by a glorious new life with new bodies on a new earth where God wipes away the tears from every eye and there is no more pain, no more suffering, no more death. And that is promised in Revelation 21 for the new earth. Not the present heaven where we go when we die. Great place, the present heaven. I'm all for it. I mean, Paul talks better by far to be there, to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. But read Spurgeon sometimes. He has whole messages about the saints in the present heaven who are awaiting the resurrection, who are looking forward to the culmination of God's program. Disembodied spirits not good enough for Paul, should not be good enough for us. It's just not what the Bible teaches. You know, the funny thing is there are a lot of people that are revising theology to make it say what they want to believe. But isn't it ironic that what the Bible actually teaches about our eternal destiny is far more appealing than what most Christians believe? Why don't we go to the thing that is way more appealing, not because it's more appealing, but because God said it? It's true. But when we go there, then all of a sudden we start getting excited. All the people that there's a whole lot of things. I mean, the world is full of things that I do not know. But one thing I do know is what people think about heaven. Because I've written books and it's thousands of letters and conversations and phone calls. I know what people think about heaven. And I know people who have been Christians all their lives and they would die before they would deny the doctrine of the resurrection, but they simply do not know what resurrection means, or they don't believe in the resurrected state. Resurrection, it's one of those rewords in Scripture. You know, there's renewal, there's regeneration, there's resurrection, reconciliation. All those rewords are restoring a state that we were once in. God didn't come into the world to destroy and abandon his plan for the world, but to fulfill that plan, to bring it back. And that's where you see Eden again in Revelation 21 and 22. First two chapters of Genesis, compare those to the last two chapters of Revelation. It's just stunning. I write novels, and in the beginning of a novel, you weave certain things in, then everything goes wrong, and then at the end, you have some level of resolution that comes related to that. That's you see Eden, you see the tree of life, which is now a forest of life growing on both sides of the great river. It's right there in Revelation 22. You see the kings of the nations of the earth who are bringing their splendors into the new Jerusalem. This is the new earth, resurrected people. Kings? Nations? Maybe Jesus was serious, that stuff about being faithful in this, I'll put you over five cities. Will there be other cities besides the new Jerusalem? Well, they live somewhere out there, the kings of the nations of the earth that are bringing their treasures in to the new Jerusalem. Read Isaiah 60 sometimes and think, we know that Isaiah 60 refers to the new earth. How do we know that? Because a couple of verses in it are quoted in Revelation 21 and 22, which we know for sure are the new earth. So look at Isaiah 60 in light of God's promises to the new earth and see how excited you can get about being with the resurrected Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Have you ever thought, what would it have been to walk with Jesus on the earth? The disciples had that privilege. What a great thing that would have been. No, what a great thing that will be. We will be with the resurrected Jesus. We're told in Revelation 21 that God is going to come down to heaven and bring the new Jerusalem. And look at Revelation 21, verse 3. Three times it uses the word with. It says, God is going to come down to live with his people, and he will be with them and be their God. And one more time, it says, God will be with his people. Where? In the new Jerusalem, which he has brought down to the new earth. With his people. So, Emmanuel, Jesus, God with us. Interesting. Not us with God. God with us. Now, when you die, do you go up out there to be with God in his place? Yes, if you're a believer in Christ, absolutely, okay. But the ultimate story is not us going up there to be with God. The ultimate resurrection, new earth promise secured by the blood of Jesus, reflected in Romans 8, Isaiah 60, 65, 66, Ezekiel 47, Revelation 21 and 22, 2 Peter 3. The ultimate thing is that God is going to come down to our place and live with us. The forever incarnate Jesus Christ. Do you ever think of the incarnation of Christ as if it were temporary? It's not. He's got a resurrection body, which is a glorified human body that will be his forever. And we're told in Philippians 3 that our bodies will be like his, and our citizenship is in heaven, and our bodies are going to be like his bodies. What was his body like? Glad you asked that question. He ate bread, and he drank wine, and the food didn't fall onto the ground because he had a real body, and he prepared meals for the disciples. And he had 40 days walking the earth. Do you ever wonder why it was so long? 40 days. It's almost like he wanted to give a picture to the disciples of what it's going to be like one day, living on earth as a resurrected person. Well, that is actually the promise of Scripture, and it's way better than anything that is often told in many of our churches and to our children, to our grandchildren. So Romans 8:28 says, we know that God works all things together for good to those who love him. And this verse tells us what we will one day see in retrospect. And Lewis has some great stuff on this. In The Problem of Pain, he says, both good and evil, when they are full grown, become retrospective. Heaven, once attained, will work backwards and turn even that agony into a glory. The curse is going to be reversed. Faith is believing that one day we are going to see that Romans 8:28 was true all along, even in those moments when we most doubted it. Joseph saw that in Genesis 50:20. You intended it for evil, but God intended it for good. Not just God made the best of bad circumstances. No, God intended it for good. He intends for good the suffering that we go through in this life. Retrospect. Now, retrospect is how we can call the worst day in human history Good Friday. Do you ever think about that? I mean, what name would you come up with? How about Horrific Friday? How about Bad, like in all caps, Friday? The worst day there's ever been. What day in human history has been worse than the innocent Son of God being crucified and taking upon himself, the sinless one, the sins of the world? I mean, does it get worse than that? But in retrospect, knowing the resurrection, knowing the plan of God, we look back and we say, Bad Friday ultimately deserves to be called Good Friday. It's not a bad name. It's a good name. Good Friday. Of course, if there hadn't been a resurrection, if he hadn't accomplished redemption, all of that, that'd be a different story. But that's not the story. God has accomplished his purpose. And one day, we'll look back in advance. So meanwhile, I mean, look back in retrospect, and we'll realize God really did work it all together. So God calls upon us to believe that right now. It's almost like a forward memory, like you're believing in advance as if you would believe something that had already happened. That's faith. That's trusting God. Trust God that He is at work in your life, even in your sufferings, and that He's going to bring eternal good out of those sufferings. Not just that there'll be the time of suffering followed by the time of glory, but the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. These light and momentary afflictions are what? They're accomplishing something. They're working toward that eternal weight of glory. Jesus didn't just say, you live in sorrow and it'll be followed by joy. He says what? Your sorrow will turn into joy. It's like the childbirth analogy. Ultimately, there is only one answer to the question of evil and suffering that's big enough to stand up. And that is Jesus and Jesus' eternal redemptive plan, where His people will indeed live happily ever after, and it won't be a fairy tale, it'll be the real thing. And if you ever say to yourself, you know, I'd never do to my child what God has done to me, and you know, He must not care. You know, picture Jesus stretching out His hand and saying to you one day, look at me. Do these look like the hands of a God who does not care? Consider what I did for you. Well, here's the thing, though. Let's none of us wait until we die to come to believe Romans 8:28 and to come to believe what truly, fully, that what Jesus is doing in our lives, He's doing out of love for us. And He'll make it all better one day and wipe away the tears, and we will see His incredible plans and what He was accomplishing that we just did not understand. Think of Reepicheep, who was not longing for Aslan's ghostly realm of cloudy nothingness, but was longing for Aslan's country where the lion's mane and hearing his roar and being able to touch the rich velvet of his fur and the real place where this real character would live. And sometimes people say, you know, physical earth and a resurrection body and eating and drinking just sounds so unspiritual. I've had people say that. Numbers of people have said that to me, in essence. Lewis says this in Mere Christianity: there is no use trying to be more spiritual than God. God never meant man to be a purely spiritual creature. He likes matter. He invented it. You can just hear Lewis saying that. Christianity is almost, this is still Lewis, the only one of the great religions which thoroughly approves of the body, which believes that matter is good, that God Himself once took on a human body, and that some kind of body is going to be given to us even in heaven, and this is going to be an essential part of our happiness, beauty, and energy. Let's not have a small and impoverished view of redemption. And if you haven't taken a careful look at the new heavens and the new earth, I would encourage you to study it and to see how big the gospel message is. Good news of great joy that goes so far beyond the disembodied spirit thing. A redeemed creation where we will eat and drink. Yes, literally eat and drink. Isaiah 25 says, the Lord God Himself will prepare a feast for His people. How good is that meal going to be? My compliments to the chef. It's God who's going to feed it. He's going to make this feast. And you would say, well, do you take that literally? Well, if we have actual bodies like Jesus and He ate and drank, won't we eat and drink? And some people, again, are thinking that's unspiritual. Well, you think of all the times that Jesus said, they'll come from the east and the west and sit at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We'll feast together. Won't that be great? Of course it'll be great. The favorite food What will be your favorite food may well be a food you've never tasted. We're going to have redeemed taste buds along with the other aspects. God will delight, and he'll be, I can just see him arranging the seating arrangements. And to the glory of Christ, he'll be the center of everything. We won't have any of the problems that we have now where we take secondary things and we act like they're primary things. But they're not. They all come from God. Lewis talked about the fountain head. You know, the headwaters. And then there are the lower streams of joy. What will it be like for the whole man, Lewis says, to partake of the headwaters of joy, the very source of joy? Because we will see in everything he has created immediately the glory of God. And if we have eyes to see, we can see that now. And Scripture says, 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Isn't it interesting that he did not say, whether you fast or pray or do Bible study or witnessing, do all to the glory of God. Whether you eat or drink, the simplest things, the most basic things that are to be done to God's glory, and we'll do it forever. Well, let me start wrapping up by getting to specifically Lewis on the new earth as he reveals it in The Last Battle. Jewel, the unicorn, mourns Narnia's death and says, the only world I've ever known is gone now. And by the way, something that I want to quote from Lewis that is a good setup for this is in Letters to Malcolm, where he says, I can now communicate to you the fields of my boyhood. They are building estates today, only imperfectly by words. Perhaps the day is coming when I can take you for a walk through them. Here is suggesting the continuity between this earth and the earth to come. Job 19, continuity. My Redeemer will stand on the earth. I will see him with my own eyes. After my flesh has been destroyed, I will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. In my body, I will see him with my own eyes. It will still be me. Jesus said, touch me, handle me. I'm not a ghost. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones as I have. I've got flesh and bones. This is continuity. It's the real Jesus, the real Job. It will be the real us. And so, Lewis says, in The Last Battle, he portrays these different characters saying, what? You know, what's going on? It's been destroyed. But then Lucy looks at something. Here's what she says. Those hills, said Lucy, the nice woody ones and the blue ones behind, aren't they very like the southern border of Narnia? Like, cried Edmund after a moment's silence. Why, they're exactly like. Look, there's Mount Pyre with his forked head, and there's the pass into Archenland and everything. And yet, said Lucy, they're different. They have more colors on them, and they look further away than I remember. And they're more like the real thing, said the Lord Diggory softly. Suddenly, Farsight the eagle spread his wings, soared 30 or 40 feet up into the air, circled around, and then alighted on the ground. Kings and queens, he cried, we've all been blind. We're only beginning to see where we really are. From up there, I've seen it all. Ettensmuir, Beaver's Dam, the Great River, Caer Paravel still shining on the edge of the eastern sea. Narnia is not dead. This is Narnia. And then Lord Diggory says, the eagle's right. The Narnia that you're thinking of was only a shadow or a copy of the real Narnia, which has always been here and always will be here, just as our own world, England and all, was something in Aslan's real world, and this is a copy of it. You need not mourn over Narnia, Lucy. All of the old Narnia that mattered, all the dear creatures have been drawn into the real Narnia through the door. And of course it is different as a real thing is from a shadow or waking life is from a dream. The new Narnia was a deeper country, Lewis says. Every rock and flower and blade of grass looked as if it meant more. And then the unicorn says, I have come home at last. This is my real country.
I'm with Aslan now, is what he's saying. I'm in Aslan's country. This is the world I was made for. I belong here. This is the land I have been looking for all my life, though I never knew it until now. The reason why we love the old Narnia is that it sometimes looked a little like this. And then they see Professor Kirk's home. And Edmund says, well, wait a minute. That home was destroyed. And then the Fawn says, well, so it was. But you're now looking at the England within England, the real England, just as this is the real Narnia. And in that inner England, no good thing is destroyed. So God is not done with this earth. He promises a new earth with a new Jerusalem. Why not a new Ireland where Lewis really might take us for a walk through his boyhood fields? Why not a new Niagara Falls, a new Lake Victoria, a new Grand Canyon, a new Minneapolis, a redeemed Nairobi, a glorified Seattle? It's no accident that Jesus was a carpenter. Carpenters make things and they fix things. The carpenter from Nazareth made the universe. It went bad and he's going to fix it. So let me conclude with some final words from Lewis, and just to come full circle where we started, let me wrap up by saying, when God creates the new heavens, will they consist of galaxies and nebulae and planets and moons and comets? Well, why not? Were they a mistake the first time? Did God not know what he was doing when he made those things? No. Might there be a new Andromeda galaxy? Well, why not? Might humanity sometime travel there to behold God's creative magnificence and worship him? If in this fallen creation, Romans 1 is true, how much more will it be true in the new heavens and the new earth to come? So consider my boyhood longings that I began with to one day visit that place. Did God put that in my heart? Many nights I still look up and often get tears in my eyes when I look at the Andromeda Galaxy, because God used it to draw me to him in ways I did not understand. And I remember that childhood longing to go there, and you know what? I've never lost it. And I just wonder, maybe, just maybe, not for sure, but I wonder if one day I will go there and many others will go there, and when we do, we will sing praise and we will worship the great God of the heavens that didn't just redeem that little boy out in the cold in Oregon, but redeemed the whole creation, new heavens and new earth to be explored forever. Ephesians 2:7, in the ages to come, God will be revealing unto us the riches of his grace and his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. Wherever we go, whatever we do, we will see God in everything. And so I conclude where Lewis does in the last battle. And as he spoke to them, he no longer looked to them like a lion. But the things that began to happen after that were so great and beautiful that I cannot write them. And for us, this is the end of all the stories, and we can most truly say that they all lived happily ever after. But for them, it was only the beginning of the real story. All their life in this world and all their adventures in Narnia had only been the cover and the title page. Now, at last, they were beginning chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever, in which every chapter is better than the one before, all to the praise and glory of King Jesus, Lord and Savior. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the breadth of your redemptive plan. We are just in awe of how vast and far-reaching it is. Lord, help us not to reduce the gospel to something smaller than it is. The unfolding drama of redemption is cosmic in its scope. Help us to see that. And the sufferings of this present time are truly not worth comparing to you or to the glory you will reveal to us and in us through the unending wonders of the redeemed universe. To your eternal praise, we thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen.